Chapter 5. The two men ride to the inn of roads less traveled, the only public inn in town. Lancaster rides up to the stables and tilts his head down, looking directly at Norman, and says, "You stay here at the stables or inn, Norman. This mission is for me alone, and should things go terribly wrong, I left a note with all the information needed on the table in my tower." Norman realizes a severity he has not seen in the somewhat eccentric Lancaster before now. He replies with his hands around his chin, "So be it, wizard. Just don't be getting yourself killed. No dimensional magic unless you absolutely have to, like before. I can't have you going around casting dark sorcery. Do I make myself clear?" "Crystal," Lancaster said with a warm and subtle smile. Norman jumped off his horse and headed inside the inn, both wooden doors flapping away as he entered. The sound and rabble and music could be heard, as well as glasses being broken. Norman Gall, now in his comfort zone, picks a table and chair vacant and closes close to the door, but near a corner. He sits back in the chair, arms crossed. The maid comes and asks, "Would you like ale, my lord? Perhaps a loaf of bread?" Norman signals no and pulls out a wooden pipe full of tobacco and lights it up. He then takes his hat off, his hair caked with sweat from the humid climate, looking up at the ceiling with his palms cupped behind his head and arms out. He worries about Lancaster. Even though he is an extremely powerful wizard, this place seems overwhelming to Norman. He then hears a hiss like boiling tea coming from somewhere on his person. He quickly checks his arms, the huge slits of his robe and coat revealing his runes, exposing them to the inn. He stops all of a sudden and realizes it is coming from a tiny brown leather book in his coat pocket, another facet of his trade, but much less common. He pulls it out, looking for the rune that is activating in his tiny leather-bound book. He looks through, realizing how far back it is. A look of dread comes across him, and he slowly looks at the last page. It is void. He flips back to the page before it to reveal the glowing rune. Norman murmurs to himself, "This is very bad." The cautious Lancaster has made it to the entrance to Ebony Tower. Two black metal claws hanging by chains beside the door, acting as braziers or torches. By now it is night, just recently. All the buildings around the Ebony Tower are seemingly abandoned, and the night is humid and hot, the wind non-existent. He walks right in, braving the dark of the first floor. Before him appears a stair. He looks up to reveal it leads spiraling through the entire tower. He looks around him to reveal many such stairs all throughout the bottom. He walks up the stairs to the second floor, revealing even more such stairs in even more random places. There is a torch on the floor still lit. "It is too dark," he whispers to himself. Torch in hand, he walks into the huge room, seeing bodies everywhere. The wizards and priests slaughtered, but there is no blood. Some have severe burn marks on places like the side of their faces, and others have limbs torn off with just some blood and mess around their bodies. Lancaster holds his torch up and frontwards to hear a deep vortex-sounding voice coming from the shadows of the corner where no corpses lie. Out walks a gaunt and somewhat weathered and torn dead man holding a very elaborate and arcane-looking book. Huge. He throws it down and it slams loud on the stone floor, dust coming off the pages. The voice normalizes it as it has been laughing this whole time. Quietly, though, he steps slowly into the light of Lancaster's torch. Lancaster realizes who it is, and his left hand slaps and stays on his left cheek, sliding down slowly. "Ethan?" yells Lancaster. "Yes, Archmage, I have been expecting you, and I have a surprise for you," says the now undead Ethan as he laughs. "These poor fools here know not what truly takes place here in this tower, not even the ones in it. They made me a lesser god. See that?" He then points to bags upon bags of cloth up against the walls of the room in droves. "Surprise?" he asks himself strangely. He goes to the bags and opens one and picks up a handful of ash, then walks to the book falling on the floor and picks it up awkwardly. and opens it in one with one hand, straining to hold it up. In his left hand, he sprinkles the ash on one of the dead priests with a burnt cheek, at the same time flipping through the massive tome. He then holds out his index finger and summons a small red glowing orb at its tip and sprinkles the rest of the ash with his other fingers by relaxing them. The priest comes back to life, contorting with teeth growing into fangs and intervals in his mouth, and his burnt flesh healing instantly, new flesh filling what's been burnt out. Making monstrous noises and howling, the vampire slithered up in the air like a bag in the wind. His fingernails extend to claws and he holds them forward. The red orb dissipates and he puts his hand down and turns to a new page. He heads back toward the sack, looking back at Lancaster. Shall we continue? Lancaster grips his staff as it is on his back and inquires, Is this what has become of you, Ethan? Some evil lich who only craves power and more power? You know I can fill your entire body with silver in an instant, almost. This cannot end well for you. Ethan then cackled, Maybe this won't for you either, old master. Lancaster throws down his staff and holds his right hand as to grip a sword, and a whip of silver, liquid silver, forms and wraps around his wrist, then at the end forms a blade. Give me your best, Ethan, I can wait, says Lancaster. Ethan replied, Are you sure? Go ahead and raise your abominations. I don't want an unfair advantage. Lancaster says and smirks. Ethan laughs maniacally and says, Your arrogance will be your downfall, master. Norman's still in the inn, is starting to reconsider his promise to Lancaster. To get another surprise, his book goes off again. This time he opens it, and it is on the first few pages. Even so, his worry is apparent. He feels too much foreboding and gets up, dusting off his cloak-like robe and running out. He runs toward the ebony tower, following its site in the middle of the massive city. He knows something is terribly wrong because vampires keep activating more and more of the same rune. Many things run through his mind. What if an army of evil is being spawned this very moment? He tries to pick up the pace but slows down from fatigue, but doesn't stop running. He runs, people jumping out of his way and others being tossed aside. He makes it to the entrance and then stops, catching his breath. He peers in to see darkness and fears the worst. He then runs up the stairs to the second floor and trips over a body. He looks for a moment, then gets up and heads for Lancaster's torch. As he heads that way, he hears battle. He then hears Lancaster and Ethan fighting near the almost darkened corner, a mere dagger deflecting some in silver spear blades. Piercing blows are the only thing to slow it down, Norman. Lancaster yells out, and he lunged his weapon into Ethan's shoulder. Ethan yelled in agonizing pain and grabbed the blade with his other arm, his hand burning and smoking, and he looked at Lancaster and smiled, his contentment apparent. He slowly removed the blade, then in a moment forced the blade into his heart. A blue light and black and blue steam came out of his body in cracks, and he then melted. Then in a sudden burst exploded all over Lancaster and Norman. Almost black blood everywhere. The vampires, also having free will, simply dispersed into the shadows of the tower, off to some unknown location, in some unknown, barely distinguishable form. The two picked themselves up and shook hands. Their business was concluded, and they now must go their own ways. The moon shines in from an opening at the top terrace of the tower, onto the large tome on the floor, the clouds obviously giving way to it. It begins to rain, and it trickles in little by little, falling on the stone stairs alone. Lancaster hands Norman the book and says, Make sure this book is burned, Norman, and go to my tower and read the note on my table. So this is goodbye then? Norman inquired. Lancaster gave a single nod and pointed to his staff. Take it, he said, smiling, then tilting his head and crossing his arms. I'm getting too old for this. Keep it safe, or at least take it to remember the adventures. Norman picks it up, wraps it up in cloth, and walks toward the stairs. Norman, wait. Here are your credentials. They will get you out of this city safely. Lancaster utters, Norman takes them and folds them in his pocket, then finally walks away, off to his horse and back to the town of Lancaster. 7 days later, after a bit of trouble getting there, Norman makes it to Lancaster Village and on horseback makes his way to Lancaster's immaculate treehouse tower on the lake. He opens the door, the house silent and bright with the morning. There is a note tacked to the table. He picks it up and reads, rubbing his brow and lowering his head. The note reads, "Norman Gall, I leave you my tower, and with it the village of Lancaster. In my tower you will find many priceless tomes and treasures, among other things. If you are reading this, it means one of two things. Either I have fallen in battle against Ethan, or I have decided to return to White Tower. Either way, it's all yours. Sell it, keep it, it doesn't matter to me. Your payment is all there and then some. This world needs a new hero. My people need one. The people of Ascadia need one. Your client and friend, Lancaster."